people actually mean when they say that they are pro-democracy. It turns out they could mean very different things. It could mean that people, A, want a deliberative, participatory, limited style of government, or B, that they simply want the right to select who leads them, after which a strong leader is able to exercise unchecked power on their behalf. Democracy could emphasize majority rule, or B, emphasize equal rights for minorities, both of which are essential pillars for democracy. So I think in countries that think of themselves as democracy, progressives have been blindsided by the sudden realization that many of our nominally pro-democratic fellow citizens express their democratic appetite by electing strong leaders who will exercise unchecked power and have no problem with pro-majoritarian tyranny, forgetting that the other key pillar of democracy is protection for the rights of minorities. And I think there are no quick fixes to this problem. But that doesn't mean that our belated realization that there's a problem is irrelevant or just too late. Because I think in addition to focusing only on the current crises, we also need to think about how to prevent the next one. Because, you know, let's be clear about this. Duterte, Trump, etc. may be one-of-a-kind leaders, but it's a mistake to think that they stand completely apart from historical trends. I don't think we should see them as freakish anomalies, but merely as extreme manifestations of certain broader, permanent dysfunctions in democracies. And I hope we incorporate these questions into our strategic planning as media or as universities. Media in particular, I think, you know, I wish they would not just, when they retreat into strategic planning mode, don't only consider how to respond to digital convergence and the collapse of the traditional business model, which they all do, both internally within companies as well as at industry forums. They should also invest into thinking how they can respond strategically to our democratic future. What is the role of civic education in fertilizing the ground for democracy? How do we explain through our stories, through our teaching, simple basic principles like reciprocity, that democracy in fact does depend on this basic golden rule that we treat others, including and especially people who are different from ourselves, the way we would like to be treated. Maybe we have not emphasized those democratic principles enough, and we've simply emphasized the principle that majority rules and numbers count. So I think we need to think long term. How can our publics better play their role as democratic citizens, since ultimately that is our only defense? Thank you.
Thank you, Shane. Peter?
Okay, I feel as I'm probably going to repeat a lot of what I said yesterday because I'm trying to figure this out. We keep treading over the same sorts of rules. But let me start with the first principles, which is really what we're dealing with here, that ultimately it comes back, it starts with us. As an industry, we need, as a media industry, as academics, we need to underline and emphasize and carry on, take what the message is in these kinds of fora and spread it more broadly that we have to change. If we're going to have a functioning society, if we're going to have democracies that work, we need to change the way communication operates. We need to fight back against fake news. We need good journalism. We need open communications if we're ever going to have integrity within our democratic systems. It starts with that. And after that, everything else flows from there, I think. First is we need governments to step up to encourage and support professional, independent journalism. Now, I know this is incredibly difficult. Politicians don't like that. They always find journalists pains in the ass, but we're good pains in the ass. We're kind of like the spinach that you have to eat if you're going to be healthy. We need to encourage politicians, to encourage the public, that they got to eat their greens at some point, not always dose up on McDonald's. Because if that's the way you end up with very serious health problems. But at the same time, it means avoiding crackdowns on journalism and journalists and their ability to cover the news. It also means avoiding censorship. In other words, don't overregulate. Recognize the fundamental element of a functioning democracy is freedom of communications and freedom of speech. As a news industry, we need to go back to what was said time and again yesterday, and again, I know this is sounding like a broken record, but we have to step up. We have to recognize that there is a loss of trust in our industry. People don't believe that what we do as journalists has integrity. We need to hold the line, as tough as it is. That doesn't mean that that's the only solution, but it is a really important part of it, particularly in our struggle for survival, for our struggle for clickbait. Our struggle for eyeballs. We need to hold that line solidly. We also need to figure out how to engage our readers much more directly. And it's more than just simply having comments boxes at the bottom of articles tweeting buttons and Facebook buttons. It means actively engaging readers. There was a really interesting experiment that The Guardian did where they got something like almost 500,000 documents, leaked documents from parliamentary accounts expenses, and they couldn't possibly go through them all, so they put them all up online and invited the members of the public to go through them and rate each document as either not interesting, interesting, but we know this stuff, really interesting and worth investigating. And because they had a vast number of their supporters go through it who were actively engaged in the research, they were invested in the stories, they were able to draw on the resources that the public had, and they were able to really generate something that was much more intimately connected with what people wanted and were involved with. Those are the kinds of models that we need to exploit and develop and explore. But here's something else that I think that we're missing, and it's a theme, or it's a gap, I think, in a lot of the conversations. Technology got us into this mess. Engineers have created this, I don't think because of any grand conspiracy to create this kind of social media monster. It's been done because people are making money out of it. It's profitable, but it's also that they started out with a lot of high ideals. But we've created, through engineering, a system that isn't working for us, that's created this monster that we call disinformation. And if we engineered our way into the problem, we can also engineer our way out of it. Now, I'm not an engineer. I'm not a social scientist in that regard. I don't pretend to have the solutions. But I think we need to put a lot more pressure on Facebook, on Google, on Twitter, to recognize that they have a responsibility. And finally, there's one other point, and it started to emerge, I think, in Davos, in some of the conversations recently, where people pointed out that Facebook in particular and Google have elevated themselves beyond mere platforms, mere stages. Facebook, I did a film for Four Corners, the Australian Current Affairs program last year on Facebook, in which we looked at Mark Zuckerberg's manifesto, in which he said that he wanted Facebook to become the vehicle for almost all political communications. And that, to me, said that he wanted to elevate Facebook to a status of a public utility. So if it's a public utility, we need to treat it like a public utility and not as a private business. It needs to be regulated and controlled in a way that creates a level playing field that's transparent and open for all of us, not as a business that holds information privately in servers in some distant country that we have no control over. Again, it's an engineering solution, but because Facebook has that ambition, because it actually has that role as a public utility, we need to rethink the way it operates and the relationship that it, or the role that it plays in our society. Thanks.
Thanks very much. Perhaps for the local perspectives, we could think about Clarissa.
Thank you. There's an attached problem to disinformation that I think we haven't had time to talk about, and I think we should all consider the hate speech that's attached to a lot of this. I think that's what moved many journalists to really organize the conversations like this, is because there's so much bullying, there is so much violent speech, there is so much misogynistic speech, and I think that is what inspires also the concern from academics and educators, is we have, you know, I'm a mother. I don't want my children seeing this. It is not just affecting the political culture and making everything divisive and polarized. It's affecting the morals and values of children. You know, we have regulations for films when they're too violent. We have regulations for television content when it's too violent. But nobody is doing anything about all the hate speech and violence and incitement to violence that's out there on Facebook that our children read. I think it's something that's really worth considering. I'm not saying we should censor, but there is a responsibility, it is someone's responsibility, to at least warn parents and warn communities that this is happening. Because if you have a 14-year-old girl on Facebook talking about their political beliefs and being bullied about it, then there's something, somebody has to be there to protect the children. And I think that's something that will speak to many Filipinos, because when we talk about disinformation, my concern is that, you know, we're talking amongst each others, the industry, the academics, the media, etc., the politicians, and it doesn't really hit close to home. You know, sa Pilipino, eh, parang malayo sa bituka. So what if this is happening? I can choose to have my day, go to work, eat my food, the next day do the same thing, it doesn't really affect my day-to-day. And but, you know, something as important as exposure to bullying and trolling and hate speech online can get people to be more concerned, and that it's not a separate question. It's attached to all of this disinformation, a lot of the violent speech that people are just exposed to. And the concern there, as Brother Armin was saying this morning, is how is it affecting how children think, how they talk? I heard a story from a grade school teacher that they had to suspend a 12-year-old child for saying the same words that the president says, threatening a classmate with violence. This is not a benign concern. I think we really need to think about how to protect the children in some way, because it's an issue also for journalists. You're not allowed to say putang ina on television when you're in a newscast. What happens when your source says it live on television? How do you deal with that? You know, these are things that I'm sure the industry is struggling with. The other point I wanted to make also is, how do we take back the wheel? I think it's in thinking about solutions, we have to start thinking about how we can be proactive rather than reactive. We have gone through this initial phase of reacting to the problem, realizing how big it is, trying to understand the scope and the scale of it. But now I think going back to the fundamentals is, how are we going to respond? We have to think about how to get ahead in the game rather than try to run after. It's sort of what I think about all the debunking of fake news. Debunking takes a lot of time. It takes, you know, for the fact checkers in the room, it takes 10 times more time to debunk a story than it is to make one up. And so is that my concern for the industry is, are we spending the time correctly? I prefer that journalists don't have to deal with disinformation. I prefer that my journalists are covering stories, doing the journalism. And I think we need to protect journalists and editors' time to do the good journalism that will be what makes the stories rise to the top. And I'm concerned that we have journalists spending their times dealing with trolls, you know, trying to protect themselves from bullies, doing all of this, and not really spending enough time doing the reporting that needs to be done. In the meantime, they are railroading our constitution, they're trying to change the system of government. My appeal is for the news industry to try to let others figure out the problem to this, like academics and NGOs and CSOs and bloggers and things like this. But we need them, as I say, I'm talking as a citizen, we need them to tell us, what are these different proposals for federalism out there? What are the details? We need to talk about not just the politicians that are playing the game, but the substance of the proposals. It's very difficult. I'm trying to understand it, and I read a lot. It's very difficult for me to find actual analysis and information on important conversations about changing our constitution. There's a lot of hysteria to covering the politics, because it's hysterical these days. Hysteria in a bad sense. And I think, how can we figure out sort of how to discuss it, to look at, focus on the substance of issues, of stories, rather than the personalities that try to take the spotlight in every given story. That's sort of what we need from journalists right now. There's so many important stories. I hope that journalists can spend time covering them. And maybe eventually, I hope, the Facebooks of the world will fix the problem with an engineering solution. Because I think, and I think there was a recent development this morning, Unilever had threatened to pull all of its advertising from Facebook. Because they said that the environment on Facebook is so polluted, people can't believe what they're seeing. And so why am I going to advertise my medicine on a platform where people are distrusting information they're getting out of it? So eventually, maybe the ship will right itself. It sort of happens in the history of new technologies, is the dark times will happen. And then eventually, users will figure out that, wait a minute, Facebook is not a credible source. When we talk about credible sources, we're talking about news organizations. But you talk to the regular person and they say, where did you read that story? I saw it on Facebook. To them, Facebook is the source. So I think eventually people will start distrusting Facebook as a source, and then they will have to turn to something else. So when they turn to something else, journalists should be ready to be there as the place to turn to when real information is needed.
Thank you. Jane?
Good morning. There is no doubt that over the last several years, journalism got harder. Our work as journalists, as media practitioners, as reporters and storytellers just became more difficult with the advent of these technology platforms, especially social media, and now, as of maybe a couple of years ago, populism. You know, this seemingly global, anti-intellectual, anti-global, anti-elite sentiment. And we have talked about fake news, disinformation, hate speeches, and Facebook's role in propagating them among ourselves most of the time. But what we've realized as journalists is that we can't just do our job of news gathering and telling stories and leave the effort of finding solutions to others. I guess it's in the DNA of every journalist to also fight this, to find the solutions and to look at the bottom of why this came to be. So by now we know that legal intervention is not the answer. It's not going to fight disinformation. It's not the solution. It even opens up our freedoms to more dangers. Allowing market forces to do the job is also very limited. We cannot say that we can rely on advertising or companies to stop advertising on some platforms because they propagate hate or do not check disinformation. It's very limiting because we know that purveyors of disinformation and propaganda are not really driven by economic or financial gains on their platforms. And then technology platforms, by way of algorithm changes, that is also not enough. We've partnered with these technology platforms. We're partners with Google and Facebook and all those other social media companies. But we do know that we have to do it ourselves. And so in my work as the head of a news organization that has a broadcast platform, a digital platform, a radio, both traditional and digital, it wasn't easy to come to terms with what we had to do. But I think we have some suggestions, or we have some realizations based on experience that we think we should already start doing. First, truth is the best defense. Whatever they attack you with, as long as your stories are accurate, as long as you are fair, you can fight the trolls, right? And then the importance of focusing on your audience. The use of technology to fight disinformation and build your own audience based on technology platforms. The need to expand our citizen journalism campaign and the need to stay relevant. When it comes to truth and reporting, I think all of us agree that that is what we're here for. And no matter how the trolls or the critics or the haters come after you, you have enough to stand on. There is also a requirement for us to correct our errors because we are not perfect. So as news organizations, we should have the humility to correct errors. When we do correct errors, we have to have internal mechanisms to respond to complaints. And in this new environment, of course, we also need to fact check. And I think our groups are already doing that. And regardless of platform, whether it's free TV, cable, radio, or digital, our content should focus on our audience. We want to be understood by the general public and appreciated by experts and professionals. And this is an important consideration for us. We need to go beyond our own sphere. We cannot just be talking among ourselves. We need to understand why a segment and a big segment of our population is vulnerable to disinformation. Why they share fake news, why they fall for populist ideas and populist leaders. Third is how to use technology to fight disinformation. The switch to digital media has attracted our users or our audience to consume our products through mostly Facebook and other social networking sites. So we have been forced to adapt to the changes in technology and business innovation. And social media has become the biggest enabler of this culture of instant gratification. But in order to fight this and monitor this closely, we also needed to make use of the tools that these social media platforms use. So how do we do that? We need to have social listening tools to help us monitor the conversations that are going on among our audiences, to understand what they're saying about certain reports, certain issues, to give ourselves more tools to understand what they need. We must not allow echo chambers to penetrate mainstream media and gain legitimacy, especially if they propagate falsehood. And of course, by calling out technology platforms and forcing them, putting pressure on them into taking action to address this is really effective, because now we are seeing the results of a sustained effort on our part to really put pressure on these sites. As far as citizen journalism goes, I think that is one resource, that is one campaign that we can all take advantage of in our effort to educate our people. We need to recognize that the public, our audience, needs to know how to access media, how to understand and process their content, which is why we are expanding our citizen journalism campaign to include a very practical, very understandable media literacy campaign as well. Eventually, this understanding should lead to enlightenment so that media consumers can analyze news reports and stories and how they impact their lives. A more developed literacy campaign in a more mature environment should enable our consumers and our audiences to participate in and create their own content that is responsible and relevant. Finally, the importance of relevance. As journalists, we constantly stop and reflect on the question of which aspects of our report or our stories or our content impact the everyday lives of our audience, our core viewers and users of our stories. To be truly in their service, our stories need to be relevant and useful to them. And in order to provide them with empowering and enabling experiences and knowledge of issues and a deep appreciation of what their lives have become. The realization is that they succumbed to this. They became vulnerable to disinformation because their lives have not changed. Over the years, politicians, institutions have failed them in their opinion. And so that is the challenge to us. And as we fight disinformation, we also need to continue telling their stories, enlightening them on the issues that they need to know, even no matter how challenging it is, because this is our mission and our infinite responsibility as journalists. Thanks.
Thank you, Jing. And last but not the least, Indai.
Okay, sometimes we feel so old these days, like, you know, we want to go back to sleep, we don't want to face social media in the morning. But the truth is, social media is a relatively young arena of expression. Our preoccupation with social media is even younger. It's like, what, a decade old at most. And fake news, quote unquote, hugging the headlines, have just been around for less than 5 years, in fact, okay. So, it's still a brave new world, as I believed it in 2007, like 10 years ago, 2008, okay. I think what the problem we have is that we traditional and social media practitioners often get lost in the trees. And we need to step back a little bit and see the world that we inhabit. We talk too much about how lies spread. We don't talk much about the context of these lies. So I'm going to go back on something that we've probably read 30 years ago in newspapers or what, college textbooks or whatever. I'm going to talk about the battles, plural, for hearts and minds. So these have shaped, really, the history of the world, the history of our country. And disinformation and valiant truth-telling have been critical components of these battles. And nothing has changed. It remains the same, okay? So the battles on social media really are rooted in the battles on ground. Now, how we fight, and I suppose we all agree that we are fighting, how we fight reflects on the values we fight for. That's a lesson number one that I've learned. We cannot claim to want to defeat the trolls and the purveyor of lies and act in the same way. It's just not going to fly, okay? How we fight will influence whether we draw people in or we turn them off or worse, we rouse them into strong opposition against us. What we need to understand is the lies do not exist in a vacuum, and the Duterte experience shows that the lies were seeded and spread in tandem with campaigns of intimidation and harassment, as all battles for hearts and minds have gone through the decades. It hasn't changed at all. These seek to target behavior and drive a wedge among the governed. So we don't win the battle for hearts and minds by allowing the recipients of this information, by clawing at the recipients of this information and heaping scorn on them. I think we do that too much these days, okay? On ground, when we try to win battles on ground. We come in as strangers. We try to share people's lives. We try to see where they're coming from. We listen, even if what they have to say causes great discomfort among us. There are no shortcuts, so I'm wondering why we think there are going to be shortcuts on social media. We cannot demand that people listen if we don't even try to listen to them too. As journalists, as netizens, as citizens, okay? And lesson number two, again, we cannot combat lies with lies. We just cannot become the enemy. It is not just the government, and I want to stress this now because we have too many self-righteous groups around. It is not just the government that practices lies. It is not just government that practices intimidation and harassment on social media. Although we must say that the Duterte administration has elevated lying as a governance SOP. And Verifiles has done a very good job of highlighting this. But instead of falling back on exigency, as we're sorely tempted to do whenever we're in danger of being drowned by lies, I think we need to pour more energy and effort into the truth, both in accuracy and in context. And we should build unities. The world will always need professional journalists. And the people who screamed a year and a half ago that we were fast being marginalized and becoming irrelevant to the world are now eating crow because our audience are coming back to us. Sorry, dudes. But whenever we give workshops, whether it's to citizen journalists or to citizen advocates, we need to keep reminding people that they are media too. So let's stop the artificial distinctions, you know. Instead of insisting on making distinctions between us, professional journalists, and them, I would rather narrow the difference. Encourage them to use the tools we now have, the knowledge we have. We've worked with citizen journalists and citizen advocates, a lot of them, and it's not impossible, it's not even hard. High school students are some of the best trainees that we've had, you know. What they need to see from us media, when we teach, we like to say we teach, educate media literacy, what they need to see is how these lessons in doing journalism, as well as the technology of production and dissemination of information, can directly change their lives. During our workshops, when we focused on how all these tools can help them tell their stories instead of us always telling the stories for them, the absorption just, you know, went triple, four times faster than us just lecturing on what we journalists can do. Once we say, you can do this, and it can help you tell your stories, then they learn faster about this. Unlike Ms. Uson, young people understand. Young people instinctively understand that ethics and standards are not beyond the pale. Young people are not coming out of the responsibilities of truth-telling, and they want to learn more about it, and we need to step up our role in that. And last, we should focus on the masterminds of lies, you know, and stop wasting our time fighting with the recipients. And we know who the mastermind is in this country, okay? The 24 news cycle has focused so many of us journalists into becoming, forced many of us into becoming sprinters. And you're seeing the race in increments of minutes and even seconds. Break first, break first, break first. Or even worse, we don't want social media to break before we do. Okay? We've paid a high price for that. We send out what people say as soon as they say them, the more outrageous, the faster we post these messages. And then we play catch up. with fact-checking and providing context. President Duterte loves that. He totally loves that. He is not the buffoon that many people would love to believe he is. His messaging is deliberate, sending people dancing this way or that through smoke and mirrors. We cannot play the game that way. There is live streaming, so I cannot understand why our first breaks just duplicating what's on live streaming. We should be adding value even in those first breaks. We should be immediately placing the truth and the contradiction side by side with his statements on first serving. And this is an area where we do not need to sprint with the pack. This is our area where our expertise and our experience must stand us in good stead.
All right, thanks so much to the panelists. That was a lot of great thought to chew on. I'll begin with some follow-through questions and then try to loop in some of the questions we've already had. So a reminder to the audience, if you have questions or comments, you could give them to our student volunteers in the sides. All right, Cherian, you highlighted the double-edgedness of democracy, but also pointed out the importance of emphasizing civic education and reciprocity, and also Peter, to some extent, mentioning change in journalism and community support. So I guess, how do we reclaim these space for conversations in the context as well when the space is open to everyone to participate? So how do we actually carve out the space that could encourage reciprocity?
Well, I guess thinking as a journalist or as a journalism educator, a lot of it just depends. I mean, there's a lot of room to do this in the way we tell our stories, right? For example, and I think this is a trend that has been accentuated, unfortunately, by the internet culture, which prizes the number of likes, the number of the popularity of posts, and so on. As if this was somehow a surrogate for democratic value or opinion. Yeah. Even in simple steps like that, you know, when we report or reflect the popularity of a cause, of a figure, of a policy, we need, as journalists, as educators, we need to check ourselves. Wait, but democracy isn't just about popularity. It doesn't really matter if 90% of citizens are in favor of some extreme move, if 10% of the citizens are going to have their rights violated as a result. So even in simple reporting like that, when we report an opinion poll, when we celebrate the popularity of a tweet and so on, we need to be reminding ourselves as communicators and our audience that this is in fact not a country that is supposed to be governed simply by majority rule, right? That there are dangers of the tyranny of the majority, their rights still matter. Numbers do not dictate what is right and wrong. And I'm sure that, you know, I have to start by saying that, you know, I have a lot of faith in the journalistic profession. I don't really think outside experts need to tell journalists how to adapt to current challenges. I think I see my role as simply suggesting that this should be on your agenda to think about. Yeah? And I've seen instances in the past when the profession in different countries recognizes that, oh yes, maybe we have overlooked some important principle. Maybe there are certain practices that we engage in that are counter to our principles. Let's go back into a huddle and think how we can reform internally. I'm very confident that if journalists just do that, recognize that there is a problem, and then go and figure out how to solve it, that you will come up with the right answers. This is why I said in my opening remarks that please include this in your strategic planning. I mean, you can guarantee that every news organization represented here and around the world will have at least three big huddles per year discussing what to do about digital convergence and so on. Please put this on your agenda as well. How do we deal with the fundamental threat to democratic culture and values? Put it in your agenda. Trust your intelligence within your newsrooms, and you will find the answers.
Right.
Anyone else wants to give that a shot? There's a related question still on reclaiming spaces for conversations. Fake news succeeds because it rings true to believers looking for confirmation bias. I guess this is a question for the communication professor. How do you suggest counteracting confirmation bias?
There's a lot of research that tells us that that's very hard to do. confirmation bias is a real problem. The speed at which people, fake information that confirms something, that agrees with you, will just be shared is very fast. It's hard to run after, and it's hard to correct. I think this is why I'm trying to say we need to get ahead of the game with real information, because if a fake story is out there and then we try to fact check it, whoever saw it already believes it before they saw it, because the algorithm works that way. It shows you what you already believe in, and then when you see it, it's very hard to change it, because in the first place the reason why you saw it was because you're biased towards it. So I think coming up with content that's unique from what the fake stuff, what the fake news out there is saying, will find that same audience. Because it's not about the biases necessarily, it's about what are the new developments that we need to know about, what is the analysis that is of value. I think we also need to remember that journalists provide us not just with facts and dissemination of information. They provide us with analysis. They contextualize what these stories mean, what the developments mean for us, how we should incorporate it into how we understand how a democratic society works. I think in relation to one of the points of Shirian in the beginning, I remember seeing recently a study, a cross-national survey that shows that even though there's a big proportion of the globe that really believes in democratic systems, but if you ask them specific questions about do you support freedom of expression, do you support freedom of the press, support for that is not as high as overall support for democracy. So when people say that they support democracies, what do they really mean? They support the name, but the understanding of the details of what a democratic system is very shallow, I would argue, for the Philippines. And so that's part of what we need journalists for, to tell us how is this new development threatening our freedoms? How is this new development dangerous for us? It's really trying to fix a story that's out there that's been believed is more difficult than reporting the new thing that's very important, and then being the first out there so that people see what's going on, let's say, with constitutional change. And so that's why, to me, it's very important that journalists tell us what's going on, separate from what the disinformation architects have out there now. Because I think then we're not falling for the distraction tactic.
Right. This still connects to your point earlier about journalists, the time of journalists being spent on checking the quality of information. So, Clarissa, in a practical sense, who do you think should lead this instead of journalists, who should be more busy about perhaps, you know, giving us good journalism and telling us the truth?
The role of academics is the long game, right? The role of academics is, first, we can't assume that people value facts and truth. I think that's the big struggle now, is how we need to teach people, we need to have people learn that having real information is actually important, because currently you will hear people out and out say, I don't really care if it's true. I don't really care if it's true. You know, but I support this administration. I don't care about the facts. That's a real discourse that's happening, and people are proud of it. And that's where fact-checking individual things is firefighting mode, right? So what we need to think about is the long game of making people aware that looking for truth and valuing truth to begin with is important, and then whatever administration comes after and whatever fake news comes after that, is you've sort of inoculated your population into valuing and looking for information that's real. Because for politics, it's harder to see the value. But what about disasters? What about typhoons? What about landslides? What about things, whether may pasok bukas or wala? What about things that really matter to our day-to-day? That's where the value is. And people will realize that when the focus is on that and not necessarily the divisive politics, then you'll see the value of truth, and then you very clearly see the value of good journalism.
A question for the journalists here. This particular person is concerned about the spread of hate speech, extreme speech, and asks the question whether it is connected to the coverage of the president, and whether a possible response to this would be not broadcasting the speech that's hateful by the president himself. What do you think about this?
We cover the president's activities, of course, as a government official. We don't carry his speeches live all the time because of programming, and of course other stories take precedence over a long speech that no one knows how, you know, what time will end, right? But I think the response is responsible storytelling and journalism. We don't really engage much in the hate speech that's thrown at us, or the bashing that, you know, all journalists are now subjected to, I guess. It's easy to get emotional and focus on those things or those attacks. But the more important thing is to find ways to counter that by coming up with stories and reports that are important, that they should know, right? And we talk about confirmation bias. I think that is really a big challenge for all journalists now, in this post-truth age. No one cares about facts because they believe what they believe. They are emotionally attached to a person, to an idea, to a certain group, to a certain social media influencer, and those guys can do no wrong in their minds. And so the challenge for the journalist is now to come up with content or stories that answers the need of the bigger audience. Because I believe that there is a bigger audience, there is a different reality out there where people care, where people want to be respected, where people want to be appreciated for who they are, where, you know, they can thrive in a democratic space. We have enough experiences and interactions with ordinary folks who don't, or who are not at all similar to the voices we hear and the noise we hear on social media. And so that would rather be my focus. And so, you know, it's not enough. It's I don't think social media or the hate speeches and the bashers there represent the good in people. And I think we have enough fighters to combat that kind, right? But we'd rather focus on telling the stories that really matter and not address those trolls or hate speech purveyors.
Right. Well, there's a lot of still ideas and a lot of questions here, the good questions we received. Unfortunately, I'm getting a signal of a minute left. So I guess a final question. There are a lot of initiatives going on at the moment. And where do you think, in terms of reflecting on these strategies of fighting back, where are we not focusing on that's important? Right? If you were to highlight where our priorities should go, perhaps, Where might that be? Maybe Inday and Peter first, and then the others.
I think we shouldn't be reacting too much. We shouldn't let the president set the pace in news, although, of course, it's a very important news subject. I think, as Jing earlier said, we should invest more in ferreting out the truth outside of the pace and rhythm of the government or any powerful entity, which means basically we go back to the basics of journalism and go where we think and we know will affect people most directly, not this hot air in politics.
Yeah, I agree very strongly with that. You know, we get very distracted by a lot of the detail of this. You know, we think that fake news isn't like a missile. You don't sort of have this fake bomb coming over and you shoot it down with a truth missile. It doesn't work quite like that. And we end up with, you know, we all end up safe. What we've got to get back to is what we're doing right here. And I want to emphasize, and again, I know this has been said before, but thank John and all of the organizers of the conference, because the more we talk about it, the more we remind people of not just the value, but the fundamental importance of communications with truth, with integrity, of the need for good journalism, the more we make people, we encourage people to look at what they're getting critically, the more we marginalize and isolate those people who are fake, who are patently trolling us with bollocks, with bullshit. And there's no, I mean, we can focus on, we should be focusing on a lot of the technical solutions and so on, but let's never, ever forget the fundamental importance of reminding people why this stuff matters and the importance of what we do. That sounds like a broken record, but really, if there's one message I want people to go away with, I think that would be it.
Sharon. Yeah, I think what I'm hearing here, which echoes my own views, is, and I agree completely, borrow Claire's terms of needing to distinguish between firefighting mode and the long game. I think it's a very useful analogy, because obviously both are important. A fire does need to be put out, right? You can't just go and read a book. But I think that one of the challenges we face right now, because the so-called fake news challenge on social media in particular is so new, so unfamiliar, so urgent, and yes, it's a fire that needs to be put out, but let's not confuse newness and urgency with importance or impact. And I'm convinced that most, if you look at hate propaganda, for example, most of the real action is not happening on social media, it's happening in churches, mosques, temples, word-of-mouth communication, as traditional as you can get. Most of the political damage that's being done is being done from election rally stages, not social media. So there is an important battle to be fought over the long term, even as we try and put out these social media fires.
Thank you.
I think, of course, we talked about truth and the need to continue good journalism. But I think I would also appeal to my fellow journalists and to all of you guys here that we need to focus more on listening to the ordinary folks out there whom we don't know very well, right? In our effort to promote diversity and tolerance of opinions and differences, I think as journalists, we also need to listen more to those whose voices are drowned out by all the noise. And I think that is also good for journalists in the sense that those guys, those ordinary people, are a source of stories for us. And we might be surprised at how little or how much they need for us to listen to them and not give them anything at all, but just listen to them and understand them. Why do they feel their lives never changed? And how can we as journalists help there? Help bring that to the attention of, you know, decision makers and the powerful people who can do something to change their lives.
Yes, thank you.
Okay. I think there was a survey once that was done by Eon Company or something that talks about institutional trust. And they found in their survey that while traditional news in trust in traditional media is dipping very slightly, it's still relatively high. It was close to 80%. But for people who are on social media, trust in traditional media was much lower. And when they looked at the chatter online and did sentiment analysis, a lot of the times on social media, when they talk about traditional media, it is negative 80% of the time. So it's there is really a space in social media where traditional media is being attacked. That is a reality, and we need to deal with that. And I think my pitch to traditional media, particularly in the Philippines in the networks, is that you use traditional media. right? Because there's still 50% of the population that's not on social media. The people on social media, let's say it's 50% of the population, not all of them are in the news channels. It's not a big, it's a big proportion consequential to elections, but in the daily making of news, it's not huge. It's really the biggest venues are still on television. It's still in traditional media. And that's my appeal to the Filipinos is, let's turn back to traditional media. I mean, excuse me for the journalists in the room that are only on social. But I think there's a value, I mean, I think that if it, there is a value in going, because that's where the that's where the quiet is. You know, everybody, I really do want to just go and read a book. I think everybody sort of has that instinct. But turning back to traditional, where people have had, journalists have had time to fact check, have had time to verify information that are said in speeches before it gets to you, so that what you get has already been checked. There's a value in that, and I think that the leg up of traditional media is that the infrastructure is there, the audience is there, and we shouldn't get too distracted with what's going on in social media.
Thank you. Well, the person who predicted in 2016 the fake news phenomenon recently wrote a piece about how we are actually facing an information apocalypse. So the prediction is a little bit scary, more scary than what we have. So I think it's going to be very crucial for us to continue these conversations and to continue reflecting on what we are starting now to fight disinformation. So thanks very much for panelists. Thanks, audience.
Thank you to our panelists and our moderator. There will be a lunch break, after which we urge you to come to be back here promptly at 1:30. It is now 12:45.
Right, back here in the studio, you just saw the conclusion of another forum there. This is still, of course, part of day two of the Democracy and Disinformation Forum, wherein media practitioners and stakeholders are discussing their response to the changing reality of information dissemination. This forum, the topic was fighting back first principles. Very interesting discussion you had there. Professor Clarissa David of the University of the Philippines College of Mass Communication said journalists at this point should focus more on continuing to do good journalism and not protecting themselves from trolls. The reality is that, you know, as Jing Reyes, her very own head of news and integrated affairs, news and integrated current affairs,